This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to Dreamland. My name is Kelly Chase, and I am the new monthly guest host of this show. For those of you who don't know me, I am the host of the UFO Rabbit Hole podcast and the co-founder of the media company Ontocalypse Productions. I was absolutely honored that Whitley asked me to take on this gig. I'm a huge fan of Whitley, of this podcast, and I really feel that Whitley is one of just the brightest thinkers, writers, and human beings in this topic. So it's an absolute honor to be here with all of you, and I hope to do this show justice. In my first episode with you, I'm going to be introducing you to a dear friend of mine, Dr. James Madden. Jim is a professor of philosophy and also the author of the recently published book, Unidentified Flying Hyperobject, UFOs, Philosophy, and the End of the World. This book is already making a huge splash in ufology, earning praise from the likes of people like Jeffrey Kripal and Diana Walsh-Pasulka. I'm really excited to dive into it more with you all here. I think it's one of the most interesting and compelling books that's been put out in the last several years, and it really gives us a way to start thinking new thoughts in the field of ufology, which is something that we've needed for a long time. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our guest, James Madden. Hi, Jim. Welcome to the show.
Great to be here, Kelly, as always. I guess it's my first time here. But it's great to talk to you as always. Yeah.
Yes. It's my first time here too. Right. So we can do it together for the first time. Well, it's wonderful to talk to you. Obviously, listeners of my show are very familiar with you, but for listeners of Dreamland who maybe aren't familiar with your work, can you maybe start us off by just introducing yourself and telling us how you, as a professor of philosophy, ended up in this weird world of ufology?
Sure. Yeah. Well, that's a good question. Sometimes I ask myself that. So, you know, as you know, I actually point this out in the book we're going to talk about. And, you know, those of who have met me before electronically like this one know, I was really not into the UFO topic until, you know, in the last few years, like a lot of people. And literally what happened for me is I was watching X-Files with my teenage kids, okay, because we try to expose them to the good things in life, okay. And right when we got to the end of season one was when the first big Pentagon briefing happened, where that summer 2021, right? So suddenly the Pentagon is sort of saying you're not crazy if you think Fox Mulder was right. I mean, I know it wasn't quite that good, but it really struck me that this piece of lore that I grew up with was seemingly moving from mere lore to something that was like being taken seriously at the levels of the Pentagon. Of course, that whether it's being taken seriously or not, it was controversial, but it was in the dialogue at the Pentagon in a way it never had been in my lifetime before. Right. And so at that point, I started listening to podcasts and things. I started reading books for it on the first time. You know, I'm sort of a book guy. So that's how I react to all things is I find the books and read them. I would like a lot of people who had never looked in this before, maybe who had been like unduly dismissive of it, was just shocked by how good a lot of the literature on the UFO was from a scholarly standpoint. Not to say it isn't mixed like any body of literature, but I was very impressed with, you know, authors I read like John Keel, right? Authors I read like Jack Fillet, authors like I read like Strieber. For me, it was to the point where I don't think this can be ruled out. Okay. We can't rule this out, which then began a process of thinking about it. And initially I didn't really think it was something that a philosopher could contribute to. Okay. And then I read, Diana Pasulka's stuff, and that really changed a lot because I saw someone trained not in the exact same field as I'm in, right, but a related field in the humanities actually making a contribution to this and raising thinkers like Heidegger and Nietzsche, that are right in my toolbox. And I realized, well, no, there probably is a contribution a philosopher can make to this. At the same time, I was writing a book on philosophy of mind and cognitive science, and I was starting to see dovetailings between the issues that I was working on in sort of my day job and the issues that were coming up for me in my sort of intellectual hobby. And I started to see a road where I think a philosopher could make a contribution to this, right? And that process, you know, culminated with me writing, you know, Unidentified Flying Hyperobject, UFOs, Philosophy, and the End of the World, which came out with Ontocalypse Press. I'm very grateful to Kelly for all her help with that. And so here I am. I'm a mid-career academic who suddenly found himself unawares as a UFOlogist.
Well, it's been really cool to watch your work as it developed. I've been lucky enough to, you know, be friends with you while all of that was going on. And I know it's been kind of a whirlwind for you since the book was published back in November. What have you been up to now? Like, how have things changed and what are you working on next?
Well, there's been lots of podcasts with the book coming out. Though I have to say, getting to come back and podcast with you again, Kelly, it's like, you know, Paul McCartney and John Lennon getting back together for another, although we didn't break up. Yeah, getting back together for like one more benefit concert or something like that. It's pretty cool. But yeah, I've loved the podcasting. I went to my first UFO conference, right? Where we saw each other there, right? I continue to write my Substack. And I recently put a piece out analyzing Bernardo Kastrup's take on the UFO that he published recently. So people actually might look at that. I have been recently named as a member of the board of advisors to the Society for the Study of UAPs, right? Which that's a great honor. I'm very excited about that and seeing where that goes. And other than that, you know, I'm just continuing to read, write, and think.
That's awesome. And I heard you have a new course coming up on morbid anatomy also.
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about that?
I'm going to be doing a course through an organization called Morbid Anatomy. They're basically an online college. I mean, not accredited, but they just offer an array of classes, mostly in aesthetics and psychoanalysis. And now they've moved into doing some courses on ufology. So Diana Pasolka's taught a couple courses there. I did one previously on philosophy of technology, but now I'm going to do a course on my book, Unidentified Flying Hyperobject, through them. It'll begin the last Wednesday of March. So, but check out Morbid Anatomy on the interweb for the dates when those come up.
Awesome. That's wonderful. So excited for that. And I think it's really great because listeners here today, we can give them a little bit of a sneak peek about, you know, exactly what your book is about. I think that what excites me most about your book is that it offers ideas that are novel and different than, you know, it's been a while. It takes a lot to really bring something new to this field. And I think you've managed to do that by approaching it from a philosophical angle, which really hasn't been done before. I'd love to kind of just dive into some of your thinking that contributed to this book. I think one of the things that I learned about from you and from this book that I've found to be so helpful in understanding UFOs and also just not to steal the name of your book, but thinking about thinking, you know, how do we think about the way that we think is the idea of object-oriented ontology. And I thought maybe we could start there if you want to talk a little bit about what that is.
Sure. You know, yeah, definitely. I actually think that is the right place to start to talk about this work. And it's interesting, you know, when you write a book, okay, and this actually will fit some of the things I'm saying in the book. It's like the book sort of takes on a life of its own, right? It becomes bigger than you in a lot of ways. And I have found every time I've done an interview about it, I've learned things about my own book that I don't think I was really aware of. Okay. And I think the sum total of all the interviewing I've done since we last talked, I think has shown me that really the book is about, in a lot of ways, ontological shock. Okay. And that term ontological shock gets used quite a bit in ufology. Okay. You know, I think it was introduced into the field by John Mack. Before that, you can find it used in a 20th century theologian by the name of Paul Tillich. I think he coined the term. But I think one of the things that, as I was working my way into the UFO world, was I was kind of struck, and I know this is a little snotty, and I don't mean that, okay, but I was kind of struck like how that notion of ontological shock got tossed around. But most of the proposals for what the UFO is, you know, most of the interpretations of it were not very shocking ontologically at all. Okay. In a lot of ways, I think most of what I've encountered in it, although I think there's exceptions, like John Keel, I think, pretty close to some of the stuff I'm up to. Okay. And there's others, right? But I think most of what I was encountering was really just doubling down on our going consensus ontology, right? As the winnowing fork for thinking about the UFO. And it wasn't seeing the UFO as actually putting our basic ontology into question at all. Okay. And the way I kind of bring this up in the book is I talk about what I call the Goldilocks ontology. Okay. And the Goldilocks ontology is basically human beings, are evolved to deal with objects on a certain scale. Okay. If I asked Kelly to count the objects, in the room that she's in right now, she would say, that she would count the chair she's sitting on. She would count probably herself, I would think, right? She would count, the computer that she's working at. She'd count the desk, right? You might count that lovely plant behind you and the posters, all those things. Okay. Unlikely that Kelly would, include the photons in the room. Okay. Unlikely, that Kelly would include the germs on the desk. Okay. And in fact, if she brought either of those up, we might even find that a little odd. Okay. Unlikely that she would count the internet as an object in the room with her, right? Unlikely would she count the Ohio Power Company, okay, or whoever's bringing your energy, okay? She wouldn't count those things, okay? And why is that? Because I'm going to make a case here that those objects are very much in the room with her right now too, but she's not going to count those, or you wouldn't count those, sorry, the third person thing. You wouldn't count those because humans are basically evolved to deal with these sort of, to use a common phrase in philosophy, these middle-sized dried goods that we can get our hands on, that we can see with our eyes, that we can touch and smell, that like make a practical difference for how we go about. Whereas like the photons don't really make a practical difference, right? The power company, the internet, is not something we can get our hands on. So we're always biased to think about things in that Goldilocks ontology. Okay. So we tend to, whenever we're confronted with something, we think of it on a scale of the things that we can put our hands on. Okay. And even if we think there are such things as immaterial objects, if you think, say, like a human mind or a human soul is an immaterial object, we tend to think of it as, sort of like a ghost, which is more or less just you, but invisible. We still think of it as this sort of Goldilocks sized object, quote unquote, in that case, right? On the basic scale of things that we were evolved to deal with. Okay. And so I think inevitably then when we encounter something like the UFO, what do? We translate it. We put it into our Goldilocks ontology. We think of it as something on the scale we're used to dealing with. So it's just a spaceship now. Okay. Right. It's something like a demon or an angel, which there though is that already kind of putting it on an individuated person scale that we're used to dealing with. Okay. And so it seemed to me this is my critique of ufology is it seemed to me that most of what I was seeing in ufology by going into, the classic nuts and bolts versus the classic angels, demons, spirits, fairies thing was really not seeing the UFO as questioning our ontology, but it was just a further extension of our normal human evolved ontology. Is that a good start, do you think?
Yeah, I think that's a great start. And I mean, it really struck me when you introduced that idea to me, because I know that when I started doing this work, I had been doing the podcast and studying UFOs for over a year before I realized that I'd actually had a second UFO sighting. I knew I had had one, but the second one that I didn't like classify as a UFO sighting was because it didn't look like what I thought a UFO should look like. It didn't look like a ship. It didn't look like, it was kind of translucent and fuzzy. And it didn't look like something that could have passengers necessarily. Yeah. And so I didn't think of it as a UFO. And so that idea really resonated with me because I recognized how easy it is to miss things when we're categorizing them in these very sort of narrow ways.
Right, right. And I want to be careful too, because I'm not saying like the desk that Kelly's sitting at isn't real. Okay. I think it is real. I'm not an idealist. I'm a realist. So I think that desk is real. Okay. I think it's real even independently of us. Okay. My point, though, is that desk is among a range of objects that are just right for us. Okay. But there's no reason to think up front the objects that are just right for us are the only objects. Okay. And we're going to tend to anything that we encounter that's outside of the Goldilocks zone of our perception and cognition. We're going to tend to try to force things into the Goldilocks zone. Okay. So another way that I do this in the book, and the way I do this in the book is and this is how I like to proceed in general in teaching and in writing, is I come at something from a lot of different angles to hit the same idea from these different angles, and hopefully it adds up to like a more plastic understanding. Is, you know, there's a famous example that's drawn from behavioral biology, and it's had some work in phenomenological philosophy, and it's had some work in cognitive science now, this notion of an Umwelt. Okay. And an Umwelt, it literally means in German, around world. And it's often gets translated as environment, but I want to be careful with that because I think that means something very different to us in English. Okay. But think of like the Umwelt is basically our Goldilocks ontology. Okay. And to motivate this, there's a famous example that's used about a tick. Okay. So apparently there's some kind of tick that's basically got three senses. Okay. And all it has is it can sense the amount of, I think it's butyric acid, mammalian skin acid in its immediate environment. So it can sense when there's more or less skin acid in its environment. It can sense differences in the temperature. So it, you know, can see heat signals, see quote unquote heat signals. And it can feel differences in the tension on a surface that it's on. So it could like feel where skin is stretched tightly, I think is how it goes. And with those three senses alone, that tick can time its jump on you when you're walking by in a way that it's going to get to the vein and, you know, put its stinger in there and suck your blood. All right. And think of it, that tick, it has a very limited sensory package. It's got those three senses and that's it. Its whole Goldilocks ontology is just built on the information that it gets from those senses. All right. And so, you know, when that tick jumps on me and bites me, all right, it's getting something right about me, right? I do indeed emit butyric acid. I do indeed give out heat signals. I do indeed have surface tensions on my skin, all that, all right? So it's getting me right. The problem is what I am far transcends anything that's in the tick's Umwelt, okay? And the way that this gets put in Heideggerian phenomenology and in object or ontology, which we'll work our way towards here, is that I, as an object, withdraw from the tick's Umwelt. I withdraw from it. I'm in it, but I'm always running away from it. And there's more of me running away from it than I dip into the Umwelt of the tick. Okay. And so, but now, no, like think of what we were just talking about is we humans are no less bound to a narrow Umwelt than is the tick. You know, our senses have been evolved to do certain very practical things. There are other ways, other things that could have been done. There are other practical demands that could have been made on us such that our senses would have evolved in different directions. Notice the tick. You and I are not sensing the butyric acid in our environment right now, though it's right here around us. Okay. And so it seems then we have to say that we too are in a limited Umwelt. It's real. The stuff we sense, I think, is there. However, it's not all that's there, and the object really withdraws from us. So in the same way that we withdraw from the tick, there's more to our being than is ever apparent to the tick. Likewise, the tick withdraws from us. There's more to the tick's being, probably, than is ever apparent to us as human beings, however hard we think in research, because it's always going to be tied back to our basic perceptual package. Okay. So the idea then is objects, as we encounter them, are always sort of transcendent of our packaging of them. Okay. Which then means like the world then, once you make that move, is very mysterious, right? There's as much in what I call the Uber Umwelt, right? The super around world, the world that's beyond what's around us. There's always more in that than what's in our around world, in our Umwelt, which means, you know, we should not be surprised when we're surprised. Okay. Because there's always more. Okay. And maybe occasionally we bump into things that are just at the edge of our Goldilocks ontology, right? They don't really fit. They're just at the edge. And you would think our experience of those things would be that they would be quite uncanny. One of our favorite words, right? It would be quite uncanny. They'd be unexpected. We might even say they would be alien to us. Okay. And you can see where I'm going here is, in general, I think if we start thinking in terms of this Umwelt distinction, we're on our way, in my view, to something like a grand theory of everything weird, okay? Or a sort of non-theory theory, because we're saying it's not countable in anything intelligible to us, but it's an account of it. It makes sense that there would be weird things now.
I think that's fantastic, and I'm excited to dive into that more, which we'll do right after this commercial break.
Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format, and believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories into it, and I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives.
All right, and we're back. So Jim, I absolutely love this idea that you're presenting. I think that there's so many fascinating doors that it opens up, and I also am really struck by how it dovetails so nicely with some of the revelations that are coming out in sort of the more nuts and bolts side of disclosure ufology. Mm-hmm. You know, things like when we think about the fact that things that David Grush is talking about, we're not just talking about, you know, bodies of non-human intelligences, but biologics is this word that's suddenly right. been introduced into the conversation. And there's long been this suggestion that perhaps some of the beings that are most often seen, like gray aliens, might actually be some sort of artificial being powered by AI or something like that. And, you know, when you talk about this, it makes me think how much that makes sense, that if you were something that existed in our Uber-Umwelt and something that maybe we aren't designed to deal with, that perhaps your intermediary would be some kind of an avatar that we would recognize as something that we could interact with and communicate with, but would also be so different from us that we would understand that it was alien in some way. And so I find it to be really valuable. And that's just one of the many ways that comes to mind.
If we wanted to like reach out to the ticks, how would we do it? Right.
Exactly.
We'd have to figure out something relevant to their Umwelt. Okay. We'd have to do it in terms of like skin acid. Okay. And think of it, yeah, in our attempts to do it would always come off as clumsy and weird to the tick because, you know, it's not our jam. And so you could say, yeah, the things that come to us from the Uber Umwelt are uncanny and weird because whatever's trying to do this is trying to remind us that there's something more. It could be part of the message. It would also could be just, it's inherently clunky to try to talk across the Uber Umwelt divide too.
Well, and that's something that you and I have talked about a lot in kind of our personal conversations with regard to a lot of the themes in Whitley's book, Them, where he talks about, he kind of makes some of those same points and tries to kind of dissect how a truly non-human intelligence might try to communicate with us.
Right. Right. And I think this is something I bring up. It's in the book, and I did it again in the piece I just did in my Substack about Kastrup's take on the UFO or the UAP. And the point is it seems to me that this is probably not something that can be figured out from our end. that's one of the themes of my stuff in general is what the UFO is doing more than anything is just revealing to us the limits of human cognition and the limits of human perception. Okay. Like I think this notion of the liminal is really, is important in many ways. And it comes up. And for me, We have to be open that this might be a limit we can't go beyond, right? And in that maybe what the UFO can do for us is remind us that in fact we do live in one among many possible umwelt, and there is a great uber umwelt out there, and the ball is not always in our court, right? That maybe there is a place where humans do need to collectively listen for something else, right? Because our attempts to like sort of put it, our attempts to make sense of it are always going to pull it back into our Goldilocks ontology, which is precisely where it doesn't belong.
No, absolutely. And I think, you know, the way that you take it one step further in the book that I think is really cool is with this idea of a hyper object. So maybe we can just start with the idea of like what a hyper object is.
Sure, sure. Okay, so let's go back to, you know, our inventory of the room. Okay, you know, like, oh, you know, although Kelly's a good philosopher, so she would have counted the photons and she would have mentioned the internet, but, you know, sort of a more naive, okay. Especially Kelly wouldn't like mention the internet as an object with her probably, right? Or the power company as an object with her, okay? There's a famous, and when I mean famous, I mean very old debate about this sort of thing, going back to Aristotle. And I don't necessarily go into all the details of the argumentation here, but Aristotle makes a very good case that anything that has an integrity of its own, meaning it, you know, it would continue to be what it is, even though its parts can be replaced, okay? And anything that has a kind of control over its parts, all right? And anything that has powers and ability that its parts don't have, if something meets those criteria, then it's a real object in and of itself. Okay, it's not just something you can reduce to or say is replaceable by its parts, okay? Aristotle mainly has in mind organisms here. He likes to point out that, you know, take you know, your cat, you know, Fluffy, and, you know, Fluffy could, you know, survive an incremental replacement of all of her parts, right? I mean, literally through metabolism several times throughout her lifetime, all of her parts at the lowest level of analysis are going to get changed over with parts in the environment. But you still have Fluffy. The cat still remains. So it seems like the cat has an integrity independently of the presence of the parts that compose it now. Likewise, you know, all the molecules and subatomic particles that compose Fluffy behave differently because they are in Fluffy's composition. They do different things that they wouldn't do outside of her body. So there's a kind of control the organism has over its parts. And then finally, you know, the molecules composing Fluffy don't hunt, they don't date in the cat way, they don't grow hair all on their own, et cetera, et cetera. So there are powers Fluffy has that her parts don't have. So Aristotle says, ergo, Fluffy's an object. Fluffy's a substance, right? Over and above her parts, okay? And we can't just say we're going to have a material story about the cat that replaces it or just reduces it entirely to a story about its parts. Doesn't mean there's some magic gizmo that's making Fluffy be. Fluffy is something like an emergent entity or a compositional entity. That's all fine. But Aristotle would assert, yeah, but Fluffy is, though, an entity. And when we're counting things in the universe, we do count Fluffy. We don't just count her parts. Okay. Now, a guy named Grab Harmon is a contemporary philosopher and I think very well worth reading. And, you know, I don't know if you do show notes in this or not, but we get some references in there if you do. Harmon argues, well, he didn't think Aristotle went far enough, okay? Because Aristotle says, okay, so the basic material stuff, the chemical level stuff is real, and then Fluffy's real, but then Aristotle's not going to count something like the population of cats as an object, right? He'll count Kelly and Jim as real and the parts of us as real in autonomous ways, but he's not going to count our friendship as an object, okay? Or our political community as an object. Only in a very derivative sense. But Harmon, and this I love this example, Harmon uses the example of a Pizza Hut restaurant. Okay. I don't know if this means he likes Pizza Hut or he has a beef against it. He uses the example of Pizza Hut. And he says, well, take any Pizza Hut restaurant. It will survive an incremental replacement of its parts. You know, probably, you know, everyone who works at that Pizza Hut probably won't work there 10 years from now. You know, slowly over time, all of the equipment's going to get replaced. You know, maybe the building's rickety, so all of its parts over time could get replaced. And we would still say the Pizza Hut restaurant persists independently of its parts in a way. Clearly, the Pizza Hut restaurant has powers that the parts don't have. Like, none of those things can make Pizza Hut pizza independently of the restaurant. Okay. So it has its own powers and it exerts a certain control. Like, we all behave differently because we're in Pizza Hut than we would elsewhere. Otherwise we'd get kicked out. Okay. Or fired. All right. So Harmon says, well, in what sense then is Pizza Hut, the Pizza Hut restaurant, not an object in the same sense that I am, that you are, that the chair you're sitting on, that Fluffy the cat is an object? He says it meets all the criteria. So he says, look, if we're going to be fair here, then the restaurant's an object. Okay. But then Harmon says, what about the Pizza Hut corporation? Well, yeah, the same argument would work. It has an influence on its parts. It will persist through the change of its parts. It has a kind of, definitely has control over its parts. Okay. So it looks like the corporation Pizza Hut, Pizza Hut Inc. is an object now, a substance operating autonomously on its own. And we can keep extending that. So probably we could say the same thing about the economy or about the environment. And it looks like there's all these grand, massive, systematic entities, in the same way that an organism is a systematic entity, that are operating in ways autonomous to their parts. Okay. Another philosopher by the name of Timothy Morton comes along, and Morton adopts the term hyperobject to talk about this. He says, yeah, there are objects that are so grand in scale, that operate on such large, like literal geographic scales and literal temporal scales. And that would be important for us. That we only get a little glimpse of them. Like, no one can get a picture of the Pizza Hut Corporation. We can go and look at this or that restaurant, but this or that restaurant is really just a part or an expression of a controlled entity of the corporation that is Pizza Hut. No one can get a full glimpse of the economy. We just can see this or that unemployment line, this or that, you know, bank statement or what have you. And those are just expressions, right, of the overall system. You know, we can't really see the environment because it's too big, too large, operating too long, too big of a time scale for us to deal, but we can experience this or that, you know, storm or this or that flood or this or that sunny day, whatever. You see, the point is there are objects that withdraw from us, okay, withdraw to us into the Uber Umwelt, that are operating at scales we can't fathom. Okay. That we just can't fathom. And so, the point I want to propose is it could be that what we're witnessing as the nuts and bolts aspect of the UFO, or even the high strangeness aspect of the UFO, are all expressions of a grand hyper object, a systematic entity that is operating in our Uber Umwelt.
I think that's fascinating. And I think those two ideas together, like you said, they don't necessarily commit us to anything, but they give us room to understand what might be going on. And I think to also argue for the thing that is sometimes hardest to argue for, especially among kind of the uninitiated and people who are new to these ideas, which is just how weird these things are, that they're that they are unintelligible to us in a very profound way, often at times. And that makes so much sense if it's coming from something outside of our Umwelt. And if it also is potentially something that is a hyper object, where we're only seeing just, you know, a piece of it instead of the whole thing, it kind of explains why the high strangeness element is so persistent in these experiences.
Yeah, because it is literally coming at us from outside of our very capacity for sense making. So it literally will not make sense to us. Okay. And I think it's important to see here is this ontological increase should come at fairly low expense evidentially, in that not without evidence, but low expense evidentially. And what I mean by that is, I think there's good reasons already to think that there are hyperobjects. I mean, I think the case that Morton makes for the environment is a hyperobject, the economy is a hyperobject. I think the case that Graham Harmon makes for the Civil War being an object still on the loose and the world having effects, I think there's very good cases to be made for this. So I'm not asking us to add something that we don't already have very good evidence for as a category. And so since we already kind of have this, or at least a lot of us have this in our explanatory back pocket, it's easy then to deploy that in looking at the UFO. So now it seems like there's this whole technological system out there that's producing machinery, okay, and psychological experiences too, that is operating in ways we don't understand, okay? Well, if you could have an environmental system, you could have an economic system, right, that's operating on scales we don't quite fathom, why couldn't a technological system operate on scales that we couldn't fathom, okay? But I think, you know, my theory has a harder time making sense of the nuts and bolts part of it, but I think it can make sense of it to say, you know, there may very well be technological systems that are vast and all-encompassing, that are operating over Umwelt, and we're just seeing little flickers of them in our Umwelt, which is the nuts and bolts stuff.
Well, another idea that you present in the book that I find to be really fascinating is that this could be potentially something that we kicked off. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah. So, I mean, take the economy. I mean, it is composed by not just humans standing around, it's composed by humans doing things, okay? So there's a sense in which the economy is an artifact of human doing. But notice, no one planned it. No one sat down and said, let's have an economy. As much as we like to think we do that, we don't. So what is the economy? It's this sort of hybrid thing that happens when you have an interaction between certain human natural doings and something else in the world that those human natural doings interact with, and then thereby create this grand hybrid object. This is something that's explored quite a bit by a philosopher named Bruno Latour in his book. I think the best place to start for him would be, "We Have Never Been Modern." Okay. And so, and, you know, Morton points out how, you know, there are now earth scientists, geologists, environmental scientists who talk about the Anthropocene as a geological age of the earth, okay? And Morton makes the case that he thinks the Anthropocene is a thing now, doing its own thing, operating on its own. But it resulted from humans doing things, going about our human business in certain ways, unreflectively, then interacting with the environment. And that interaction brings about a higher order object that now seems to be running the show from top down. And so, you have the UFO, although I think, you know, we can make the case that there's always been some kind of, you know, appearance of thing in the sky to humans. In Vallée's work, you see that. In Carl Jung's work, you see that. A lot of people have pointed that out. But it picks up, it takes off, as it were, in the mid-20th century, or maybe a little earlier than that. And, well, I think this hypothesis can make sense of that, because suddenly human beings are literally going into parts of the earth we've never gone to before, up in the sky with our technology. We're doing things like introducing all sorts of communications technology, radio, television, all these things that are having a human effect in wavelengths and like in different places, literally, than we've never had an effect before. And then we start lighting off nukes. Okay. And so we introduce all these new things into the world. Well, it seems perfectly plausible then that our getting out of our lane, our kind of moving beyond what we were originally evolved to do, you know, in our Umwelt, it's causing us to interact with things that were out there that we've never really encountered before. And the result of that is going to be a new systematic object, a new hyper object, okay, that's going to now have a downward effect on us and whatever the heck was out there that we bumped into, okay? And so once again, it's sort of like the UFO as a single kind of organism that has emerged from the human interaction with the environment, much like the Anthropocene is sort of like an organism that emerges from the human interaction with the environment, or you know, the Civil War was an organism, or is an organism of its own, that emerged from a human interaction with this environment. I'm proposing that maybe the UFO is something like that.
I think that's really profound. And it also speaks to something that experiencers and contactees have been reporting for decades, which is that they are getting some kind of a message from non-human intelligences that boils down to, you know, we are you. And yep. maybe they are us in the same way that the economy is us and the satellites orbiting the planet are us. But it's some kind of, in some bit, we've sparked a hyper object that is us, yeah. But is also kind of able to have this downward effect on us also, able to control us.
In the same way that you might talk to the cells in your body and say, you are me. Like you are an interacting part of me. or you could, or maybe, you know, you are us, is we emerged from your activity and now we have a life of our own and we're running it, right? Which seems to be a certain kind of trouble humans are good at getting ourselves into, right? Of creating these systematic holes that then run us, right? I.e. the internet.
Yeah, no, I think that makes so much sense. There's one more idea in your book I want to get to, and we'll do that right after this commercial break.
Sure.
Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world.
So the other idea in your book that I wanted to get to is obviously the second part of the title is UFOs, philosophy, and the end of the world. And we've talked about UFOs, we've talked about philosophy, but what exactly do you mean when you talk about the end of the world? And why do you feel like that's so important and relevant to this conversation about UFOs?
Yeah, that's a good question. One of the tropes of the UFO conversation is apocalyptic. So I'm playing on that a little bit. Okay. Maybe even having a little fun with it. But also, more seriously, I mean, maybe the UFO portends the literal destruction of the planet will be fine. Destruction of the human race. Okay. Or, you know, like literally the destruction of sentience and the rest of it. Maybe that's it. I'm not ruling that out. We're doing our best to rule it in right now, it seems. Okay. But when I say end of the world, I mean world more in the phenomenological sense of the world. And so you might have said, UFOs, philosophy, and the end of our Umwelt. Okay. And my point is it does seem that the UFO is showing up for us, you know, at a point in our history when we sort of feel our sense-making abilities are starting to like fall apart a little bit, that we're getting ourselves into trouble that seemed to outstrip the human ability to like reason our way out of. Okay. And Carl Jung, you know, already in the 50s, and I still think his like unmatched classic book on the UFO, he's already bringing this up. He said, you know, it's not surprising to him as a psychoanalyst that people are having these visions of technological objects in the sky portending the end, right? Or demanding a return to the whole again. It makes sense because he says, look, we're at a moment of crisis unprecedented in human history that humans have taken on the ability to destroy themselves. Right. And so of course that lends itself to a literal apocalyptic notion, but also lends itself to the sort of phenomenological apocalyptic notion is that it seems that all of our things that told us that we were special, we're running things, that the world is here for us. It looks like we're on the verge of making sure the world is going to get on very well without us through our own doing. And that leads to a kind of self-questioning that's, I think, radical in human history. All right. And now enter the UFO. And Jung is not dismissing the reality of the phenomena. I mean, you can tell when you read his book, he kind of wants to, but he just can't do it. He's, you know, it's not just a projection. It's not just a projection because he points out people see the tracks of them on the ground. You know, it's been tracked on radar, all these things. And so what's going on there is it seems like whatever is showing up here is showing up to us at a time where we really need to put ourselves into question in a way that humans have not before, right? And it seems like repeatedly to me, the message of the UFO is anti-humanist, not anti-human, but anti-humanist to say, look, you guys are not the point of this whole thing. You guys are not really running the show. All right. It's this sort of like message of humility. All right. And if you think of it, you know, so right now we're at this verge of not just nuclear annihilation, but this sort of like introduction of these other technologies with, you know, artificial general intelligence and the internet and all these things that seem to be like, you know, suggesting that we might be replaceable by our own technology, that seem to be, you know, sort of like undermining our ability to like pay attention to anything but our own sort of worldly, you know, often vapid concerns, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, I won't rehearse all the griping with the internet, right? And at precisely that moment, you know, something is showing up and saying, hey, don't you hear it? You guys aren't the point. And you're thinking you're the point is really what's undermining you right now. Like your very self-obsession is what is undermining you, right? And that to me, that the sort of the end of the humanist world, right, is I think what we're seeing with the UFO.
I find that so fascinating because I do think that that's a sense that a lot of people have. You know, I think that in more fringe communities and, you know, even the experiencer community, that the idea that, or, you know, religious or spiritual communities, the idea that the end is nigh is kind of ubiquitous. But yeah. I think that even among kind of just your everyday people walking down the street who don't think a lot about these things, that there's this sense that we have, especially in Western culture and probably globally, that we're about to come up against something from which we won't escape, kind of in right. being the same thing that we are now. Yeah. And it's interesting how all of that is happening while this kind of growing emergence of non-human intelligence is happening in our public awareness and, you know, the emergence of AI and, you know, for the first time in decades, I think there's real anxiety about the use of nuclear weapons. Like it feels like something that could potentially happen tomorrow and we wouldn't be totally shocked. And it's right. wild how that's all kind of happening at the same time.
All at once. All at once. Right.
Right.
Yeah. I agree. And you think of it, you know, just the kind of cultural changes that have gone on for both good and ill for the last couple of generations, the basic package of what a human life looks like from cradle to grave has changed very radically at a speed that it never has before. For a couple hundred years, it's been on a crazy upswing and change. But just in the last, you know, 70, 80 years, it's changed it's many ways for the better. But it does seem at some point we're like outrunning what we were evolved to do, and our abilities to make sense of the world that we're in are just evaporating around us, right? Now in the kind of like Heideggerian approach I have to these things, you know, there's a gloominess about that. They are our umwelt, our sense making possibilities are going away. Okay, but there's a lot, like the only way we're going to get through our humanistic obsessions, which I think are our problem, that they're the source of so many of our problems. The only way we're going to get through them or over them is to kind of ride this thing all the way down to the bottom. That's Heidegger's view. Is you just we're going to have to just ride the techno-nihilistic train all the way to the bottom. Because then and only then will we be able to listen to something that might speak to us from the Uber Umwelt that might be able to turn us around. Okay. So in a way, you know, I'm like this pessimistic optimist that I think we're on rails that we can't get off of in terms of wrecking our ability to make sense. But I also think that might be the only thing that's going to produce a kind of cognitive space for us to hear the message.
Yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense. You and I have talked about this personally a lot, and, yeah. you know, I share a lot of your pessimism about this. But I'm also ultimately an optimist, and I'm always looking for like, how can I feel good about this? Because I do feel like humans and humanity are a valuable thing. Right. And to watch us not necessarily even destroy ourselves, because it's hard to know if that's what's happening, but we're going to stop being the thing that we are. Our technology Exactly. seems to have made that certain. And it makes it strikes me that a lot of this, what we're talking about, is sort of it could be kind of a global initiatory process. You know, there's always that moment in the hero's journey where it seems like all hope is lost. this, yeah. It's that absolute, like, the pit of darkness where it feels like the hero is lost and it's all over and nothing is ever going to be good ever again. But you manage to rise past that, or rise to that occasion, and you do become something new in the process. Like, that story is ingrained into us. I guess I just worry that people don't have the will and the self-awareness to rise to the occasion in that way, that in some ways we become too passive. But I do see an opportunity there. If you can rise to that dark moment and allow yourself to be transformed into the thing that you need to be to take it to the next level, that there is hope there, I think. And I try to cling to that.
Yeah, me too. And I think you strike one in favor of the pessimism in a way, you know, because you and I think are in agreement here, is like the stakes aren't, like, Heidegger actually says this. He thinks the worst fate for us would not be nuclear annihilation or environmental annihilation. I mean, he doesn't take that lightly, but his view is that we would not do that to ourselves and just become oblivious to being entirely, that we would be just so ensconced in our technological nightmare that we just cannot pay attention to anything but our own obsessions. Okay. So I think there's a risk here that we could become so distracted. We could become so, you know, huffing our own fumes so much. And now the technology is only making that worse, that we can't listen. Okay. But then for me, that becomes, okay, that's the mission. That's like what you're doing. That's what Whitley's doing. That's what, you know, like a lot of people are doing, is to say, look, there seems to be something to try to get through to us. Let's look at that thing. So for me, that becomes the mission statement.
Yeah, I was really influenced by your work in naming my media company Ontocalypse Productions. And Ontocalypse, for me, felt like a really important idea, because I think that what we're talking about is more than just ontological shock, like beginning recognizing this hyper object at its edges and seeing it peep through our umwelt, like that causes ontological shock. Right, exactly. That causes ontological shock. But I think that what we're approaching as a species is more of an ontological apocalypse, which is, you know, where all of those things kind of get torn apart and put back together. And that is really scary, because we don't know what's going to happen. Because if we could even think the thought of what that process is going to be, we would already be on the other side of it, right? Like but we can't conceive of what that ontological apocalypse is going to be or what form it's going to take. And seemingly from everything that's going on in the world, it could take a lot of different forms, and maybe a lot of different forms simultaneously. But it feels like we're talking about more than just something that's shocking, but something that's kind of annihilating in a real way.
Yeah. You know, By the way, as you know, when you told me the name of your company, I was like, I must be a part of that. The name is so perfect. Apocalypse also means revelation. You know, so the last book of the Christian Bible, you know, is sometimes called the book of Revelation and sometimes called the apocalypse. And so the apocalypse is the revelation sort of what was always there all along, right? So that's what, you know, so what do we have? What's going to be revealed to us is a different ontology, a different way of being. But, and that could be great. And even if it isn't great, it's what is. And I think you have to learn to embrace what is. But this thing that's being revealed to us, this way of being, is not our way of being, or at least not the one that we've been living for, you know, the last, you know, tens of thousands of years. And it's very, like, this is what sort of the views I have about the afterlife. If there is an afterlife, it's very hard for me to look forward to it, because it's so different from anything I can fathom in this life. So I don't know how to look forward to something I can't even understand. All I know is it's not my life now. Okay. Well, what are we kind of finding out here with this notion of apocalypse and revelation? Is like, the world has an afterlife, right? Humanity has an afterlife collectively. And that could be great, but I don't know how we can look forward to that, because it's not us. It's not what we are now.
Yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense. And I think that
pessimism, I'm not sure. Sorry, Rob.
No, absolutely. And I think you see that anxiety in our culture a lot. There's sort of a lot of wishing ourselves back that goes on in our culture now.
Yeah.
You know, all of our feelings of, you know, hope and optimism are often kind of rooted in this idea that we can go back, you know, to the when things were more stable, when things were, you know, whatever time period a person thinks was, you know, best. Well, mostly in like the last 40 years, or like back to the 50s or maybe back to the 90s, yeah. Or when things just didn't seem quite so heavy. But unfortunately, it seems like, you know, we have to look forward, even if we don't know what exactly it is that we're looking forward to.
Yeah. And just using the 1950s as an example, when anyone, you know, in my circles talks about how great it would be to go back to that, I'm like, well, are you a woman? Because I don't think so. You know, are you an African-American? I don't think you want to go back to the 1950s, right? Sort of, you know, one person's nostalgia is someone else's nightmare. And I think that's important for these kinds of things. Have we ever talked about a book by a guy named Jonathan Lear called Radical Hope?
I don't think so.
Okay. This is one of my favorite books to come out in like the last 10 years. And Jonathan Lear is a brilliant philosopher who is taught for a long time at the University of Chicago. He wrote a book called Radical Hope, which is a recounting of the life of the last chief of the Crow Native Americans. Okay. And his name was Plenty Coop. And Plenty Coop was the chief who brought them into the reservation. And after he brought them to the reservation, you know, many years later, he had a friend who was writing a biography of him. And he asked him to give his life story. And he gave this brilliant life story from his birth and like hunting the buffalo as a youth and then fighting in the wars. And then he gets to the reservation, and Plenty Coop was a relatively young man at that point when they get to the reservation. And then he ends it right there and says, and after that, nothing happened. The thing that happened was nothing, right? Nothing happened. And the biographer said, what do you mean? You know, we've been friends all that time. And Plenty Coop says, well, you would be better able to tell me what happened than for me to say, because nothing has happened. And what he's saying is the ontology that he lived in was all built around the buffalo hunt. And that was over. As soon as they got in the reservation, it was over. So he was unable to make sense of the world anymore in any meaningful way at that moment. He had an apocalypse. His world ended. Okay. And I think what's going on, we're experiencing nothing happening right now. Okay. Now, interesting thing about Plenty Coop is he had this choice. He was still the leader of his people. And he had to choose between, on the one hand, there are elements who are saying, we got to go out, you know, just like some of the more radicals did, and like they'll go the way of Sitting Bull, or you know, or Geronimo, and just better dead than to go to the reservation. So it's like it's sort of like suicidal. There's no way things could be but the way they were in our past. They kind of cling to the past, and there was all these religious revivals of the old religion and stuff for them. That we're just going to bring it. We're going to like go back to the way it was. And Plenty Coop says, well, it's just not available. We can't do that anymore. All right. And there are others who said, hey, let's just become like white people. Right? Let's just assimilate completely, all that. And Plenty Coop says, but that doesn't work either. Okay. And what he said, he has a dream in which he's told he has to have the virtue of the chickadee. And in their mythology, the chickadee is a mimic. And what he means by mimic is we have to listen. We have to learn to listen for what to do. Okay. And so Plenty Coop just sort of holds himself in a kind of suspension, waiting to hear something new. And along the way, he actually turned the Crow into the most successful tribe that went to the reservation, because he was willing to kind of like hang out in the nothing and wait for something new to show itself. I think it's a beautiful story. Yeah.
It is beautiful. And it seems like it really applies here, and that, you know, there seems to be something that's, like you said, trying to get our attention. And whatever that thing is, we might want to try to get still and listen to what it has to say, because it might be able to help us.
I counsel the virtue of the chickadee.
I love that. Well, that's an amazing place to leave it for the free portion of the episode. We will be continuing with another 30 minutes of conversation for paid members of Dreamland, and I hope you guys will join us over there.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week.
Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.